4.3 billion people live across this vast continent called Asia, and we are telling their stories. On this edition, Staying On, millions of Chinese are leaving old villages for cities. We visit the few who stayed. And Reconstructing Heritage, how architects and designers are breathing new life to one of China's crumbling traditional villages.
I'm Ryan Chua, and this is Assignment Asia. Welcome to the program. A wave of urbanization has been sweeping China for decades since the dawn of economic reforms. Today, more than half of all Chinese live in cities. But there's a casualty in the process: traditional villages, cradles of Chinese culture and heritage. On this episode, we tell the story of China's traditional villages, a million of which have disappeared in the last decade as more and more people move to cities in search of opportunity. First, we head to a millennium-old village in Shanxi province that's nearly abandoned. I met a handful of residents there who chose to stay, even when everyone else has moved out.
On these mountains of Shanxi province in northern China, there's hardly any sign that a community exists. Everywhere, only dryness and desolation. But further up the rocky slopes, about 70 kilometers away from the nearest city, lies a community cut off from the noise and chaos of the urban world. This is Dachang village. It's early in the morning, and Han Shuangyo is ready to work. Shovel in hand, he walks several meters to a patch of land where he cultivates potato. At 80, Shuangyo is among the oldest villagers here, but his health is still in top shape. He's lived here all his life and has seen the village in both its glory and decline. But that's all history now, part of a distant memory villagers like Shuangyo would often reminisce about. These days, only the sound of the wind and animals echoes through the mountains. Living here is about embracing silence and isolation. It's a community with hundreds of homes, but only 17 residents.
Having existed for more than 1,000 years, this village is one of China's oldest. But as many parts of China continue to urbanize, more and more people are moving to cities, leaving places like this at risk of being deserted and forgotten.
Dachang is one of only around 2 million ancient Chinese villages that exist to this day, according to the Chinese Traditional Village Protection and Development Research Center. A million have disappeared from 2000 to 2010, their residents swept by an urban wave that China's breakneck economic growth unleashed. For those who stayed behind, life goes on every day as it always had. While her husband tills the land, 78-year-old Liu Tiaoxiu prepares lunch at home. Villagers here are self-sufficient, growing most of their own food, living without many of the conveniences of city life, like heating. Tiaoxiu moved here when she was 17, after marrying Shuangyu.
Yemenai, Jason, that's the Nahari Nasadi Toya again. Gumazawa, 不是花费，这粮食到好，谁也吃得好。吃好之后，身体之后，平原不耐地点的人之后，身体好。双女文条秀
live in a house that 24 people, including their children and grandchildren, used to occupy. Like many other villagers, they've all left. They would visit from time to time, bringing food and other supplies, or during special occasions like the spring festival.
This village used to be teeming with people and activity. Back in the 1980s, there were more than 300 residents here. But over the years, people have been leaving in droves, and so most of the houses here are now empty, dilapidated, and crumbling.
The houses here, all made of stone, mud, wood, and bricks, were said to have been built by descendants of a family who fled conflict in southern China during the Song Dynasty between the years 960 and 1279. Through war and disaster, the village survived. During the Second World War in 1943, the Japanese army massacred residents and burned houses here. The population grew after the founding of the People's Republic in 1949, but flash floods in the late 90s forced many residents to leave. On that same year, the local government gave the villagers some money to encourage them to migrate to urban areas. Only the elders stayed. For many of them, it's just unthinkable to leave their birthplace. Shuangniu's grandson Junping was among those who left after the floods. Now a police officer, he was 13 when he moved to Yi County's town center with his parents, who were eager to chase opportunities.
上学没法上了，我下山了不是，下山上学呀，政府的号召吧，完了以后搬出去，政府还给了个补贴，然后就搬到山底下这些村儿，还有县城周边一些地区。
Today, Junping lives with his wife and daughter in a house he bought, making a living not only from his job, but also a car wash business. He visits his grandparents at Dachang almost every week and has fond memories of village life.
村里面有自己的戏班，完了到逢年过节的时候，村里边的戏班就会给老百姓唱戏，完了左进这个周围的村儿，那些老百姓都来我们村看戏了，那时候挺热闹，挺红火的。
Junping is now a registered resident of Yi County, enjoying a good life. Living in the village again is far from his mind.
现在回去你首先第一个问题没学校，孩子上学是个问题，然后这个村里边你也没个医生啥的，你有个病病痛痛的也不方便，这两个问题是最大的问题。居住环境啊。
But there are some who have returned. Han Xiaowu was 12 when he left Dachang for the county center. Now 45, he came back a few years ago to run a business raising and selling sheep.
村庄在这没有是发展前途吧，就是在外边念书，这是中学时候出了乡里边念书，家里都父母各都搬到城里边去了，去到城里边了，就是找工作，就打工，老家这个上山环境啊空气啊各方面都好，咱回来搞这个样子，回来我们弟兄两个回来就卖了鞋样就搞起这个啊。All
over China, there's nostalgia for rural life. A report by the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences found that nearly 7 out of 10 migrant workers in cities want to go back to the countryside at a certain age. It's one of the reasons folk culture advocates like the author Feng Ditai believe traditional villages must be preserved. And he says it's not only about giving former residents communities to return to.
村庄是我们中华民族最早的、最古老的家园，所有的城市都是从村庄里边发展出来的。 村庄里有它最原始的、最古老的一个文化的积累，它也是文明的发源地。那些各式各样的文学艺术，比如民间的文学、戏剧、音乐、美术，是吧？还有包括传统的节日风俗，都是在农村形成的。所以呢，它是我们文化的根。
Feng's group has been doing research and providing data on villages to help in government's preservation efforts. Even as it plans to expand cities and attract more people to migrate, the Chinese government has in recent years pledged to pour resources into preserving traditional villages. At Dachang village, residents say they receive financial help from the local government. There's now electricity and running water. Roads leading to the village are being paved to encourage tourism, which gives villagers some income, as well as to ease travel for their visiting relatives. There are also plans to repair damaged houses. Because of their age and their sheer attachment to the village, Shuangyou and Tiaoxiu do not see themselves ever moving out of Dachang. For Dachang's elderly villagers, the village's existence depends on their own. Most of the villagers' relatives for now have no plans of coming back. And the villagers understand, knowing life will be better for their children in the cities. It's uncertain what the future holds for Dachang. But its handful of residents vow to keep the village alive for as long as they are.
The local government of Yi County is pinning its hopes on cultural tourism to save the village from vanishing, as well as to give villagers a source of living. Coming up, we'll take a look at the efforts of a group of architects and designers to reconstruct an ancient village and make it a tourist attraction.
Meet China's decision makers and thought leaders. See them in action. Hear their views. Debate their policies. Meet China's leaders with me. I'm Robert Lawrence Kim. From emerging powers to expanding partnerships, from fighting poverty to combating climate change, booming economies, war-ravaged nations, and everything in between. We capture the changes affecting the most dynamic and diverse continent on the planet, taking you beyond the headlines to the people and their stories. Asia Today, delivering Asia to the world. Sports Scene, the heart and soul of sport.
Once abandoned, village houses usually end up in a state of disrepair if they don't crumble. But at a village in Henan province, certain individuals have stepped in to stop that from happening. Yang Zhao witnessed how a group of architects, designers, and planners are reconstructing an ancient village to attract tourists and revive a dying countryside.
On this mountain in China's Henan province, a village that has existed for more than three centuries seems hidden, surrounded by bamboo trees. Near the creek, worn out but sturdy walls enclosed the ancestral hall, or Citao, which has protected Xihe village since the Qing dynasty in the late 19th century. Xihe village is part of Xing County, one of the poorest counties in China. About 25 years ago, the central government encouraged young people here to work in big cities like Beijing as part of policies to support the county's development. Zhang Si'en, then a fresh high school graduate, was one of those who left his birthplace. In the following year since they left for Beijing, two-thirds of villagers in Xihe moved out as well, mostly taking on jobs as construction workers in cities. Many did not return.
Zhang
owned an interior design business in Beijing. In 2013, Xing County's government asked him to contact Luo Deyin, an architecture professor at Tsinghua University. Luo was invited to help preserve the village by renovating and turning it into a tourist destination. Back then, Zhang didn't know his hometown was about to change.
三年前我们差不多三年前，我们来到第一次来到这个西河村的时候，有一点特别打动我们，就是它的这种河流和这十几棵、几百年的大树，所形成的这么一种气氛和美感。第一次来的时候就觉得西河村是我要工作的这些村子，因为这个村子难度最小。Luo
has spent much of his career writing books and articles on the architecture and history of China's villages. He catalogs and preserves rural culture and architecture in China. But as the realist, he is pushing for a more flexible approach than just repair. Modern design intervention is necessary, and tourism can be the most effective way to make Xihe village survive. But he also wants to prevent too much commercialization from drowning out the local culture they aim to preserve in the first place. Renovating the village for both villagers and tourists was the idea that Luo and his team wanted to carry out. Their work began in this abandoned 9050 warehouse complex.
看到这个房子的时候，我们不得不说，一下被我们就被打动了。它的室内是非常的具有震撼力的，12米宽，有4十多米长。我们现在的会场，木构架非常的完美，保持的非常好。当时我们的第一感觉就是说很震撼，这个空间很有力量，很有魅力。我们其实当时就想留这么把这个空间里最大的一栋房子，我们是留给我们是希望留给当地村民的，所以我们在流线组织上也是把它可以绕开的，就是说游客是可以，和村民共存的。原来封闭的房子打开，把墙打开，它变得视线有通透，空气进来，光线进来。希望它是适合这个环境的，它是融入的，所以你可以看到，虽然我们用了竹子这种处理，但是它其实是本地的素材，就在这个离这个村子非常近，大概不到1公里就一片竹林。这所有的竹子都是从那个竹林采的，它既能够用当地的材料，来反映一个当代的建筑，同时呢，它又不是那么的费钱。 我们可以看到餐厅的西面那道花墙，那个其实是我们和工匠一起完成的，那个是我们和工匠的共同的创作，是我们设计的，但是里面很多细节是工匠改了我们的方案，但是这个改得非常精彩，后来的效果其实超出我们的预计。当地人其实平时是当地人利用率非常高的，晚上在这唱卡拉 OK， 曾经还在这办过村农民婚礼。因为有了公共空间，就有了生活，就有了公共活动，那么村庄就重新有活力了。
Another part of the complex has been redesigned into a tea oil showroom. Tourists can participate in the traditional way of extracting oil from local tea oil trees.
这个最古老的，这有现在有200多年了，可能在清朝有很多人看。现在现一代的年轻人都来看，没有见过。那要教他怎么做，怎么出油。
人们参观完了南侧的博物馆以后，参与了榨油，他很兴奋。其实我们还帮村民做了一个品牌，叫西河粮油，就良心的粮，也是从西河粮油博物馆这个衍生出来的一个产品。我们其实希望把这个产业链拉长。我一直认为，在村庄的复兴里面，建筑只是排头兵。复兴农业和产业才是核心，所以我一直包括现在，我也希望能够把产业链拉长，为村庄带来产业的收益。
Zhang Suan and his family returned to Xihe when reconstruction began in 2013, seeing the potential of tourism to improve villagers' lives. He called on locals to organize the construction team with experience in building and decorating.
因为我们那个村子很特别。一是张姓家族，都是一个张姓后代，有家族的力量。这么好的一个事儿，在乡村复兴上，我们作为我们当时我们想找了几个兄弟和叔叔大爷，就是有能力的几个人，想到就是必须，把这事儿撸到我们一代人头上来，必须把它做好，迎接好。
Zhang now heads a village organization running the reconstruction project, where other villagers can invest their land and money.It plays an important role in the reconstruction effort because of people's trust.
这种天然的信任感是非常重要的。你就看那个孩子，就是以前我看着他长大的，他说带着我们一块干活建设家乡，我信他。但你要外来一个人，不管你多么慷慨激昂跟他讲，我要把这里建设多好，他说真的吗？所以我们在整个不管是在建筑的方面还是景观的方面，其实村民都是有参与的，男女老幼在。河道里面就是捡垃圾啊，砍树啊，然后铺路啊，就是这样一个现状。所以他们已经全民参与到这个过程中了，他就很少会出现那种再有对抗的情况出现。
Communication with locals is the most important part of the reconstruction process, yet it is also the hardest, and at times Luo's team had to use tricks.
实际上，整个这个村庄古村落的背后。的这个山形是很像一个卧尸，然后整个卧尸趴在这里的时候，其实我们现在看到这组石头就是伸到河里的时候，就是那个狮子的爪子，但是当时就在这个狮爪上面的时候，是有一组两层的红砖的建筑，然后这个的话其实不管是从整村的这个风貌的角度来讲，然后它跟村庄整个的风格是不相协调的，但是拆这房子就会变得很困难，因为在村里面你要把一个比较新的房子拆掉这个事情就涉及到的人员关系啊、经济啊，特别复杂，所以我们其实是用了一个比较巧妙的风水学的理论，也是在村子里最容易奏效的一个理论，就可以解释说，如果你把整个这个保佑着我们祖祖辈辈生活地方的这个神狮的爪子给压住的话，那么肯定这个神狮不能动弹，就没有办法保佑我们当地的村民。所以在这种舆论的一个压力之下，然后再结合就是一定的经济补偿，就是另外选址让他做造新房，然后这个事情就很顺利的解决了。
Now change is happening. Tourists have been flocking to Xihe Village, and more villagers are coming back.Zhang Suan says that when the reconstruction project started, only 50 people lived here. In 2016, the population is expected to reach nearly 200. Like many old villages, Xihe doesn't have a school or hospital, but it is close enough to the county center. Lode's goal now is to let people live in old houses on the other side of the creek.
一开始我们以为是钱的问题，后来发现不是，钱还不是最重要的。产权的问题更麻烦，因为每个院子都有四五户家人， 只有这四五家人同时同意，那个院子交给政府来打理，这一个你才能下手去动这个房子和利用这个房子。但是要做到四五家人同时都同意呢，又不太容易，所以这种谈判的过程就比较长。目前呢，村民还是不愿意住在老房子里。老房子就住的一是不舒服，确实有这个问题，另外一个还是这个观念不是那么容易能扭转过来的。这个观念还是大家认为还是新的才是更高级。那么目前并没有很多的居民愿意搬回来住在这个老房子里，这是我们下一步需要努力的方向。
In the end, Luo says the best way to preserve Asian villages is to let people inhabit them again.
继续住在里头呢，对于这个乡村遗产的保护就特别重要。要不然的话，它就只能是展览。要只是展览的话，那它的保护的成本就只能由政府承担。政府承担了修复的成本，也没法承担维护的成本。
And so ultimately, the hope is for owners of old houses like this to come back and bring them back to life. For Assignment Asia, I'm Yang Zhao in Henan Province, China.
The team plans to replicate their efforts in other villages. They say they're racing against time, with more people expected to leave the countryside as part of government's efforts to turn China into a predominantly urban society. You can learn more about this and all the stories on today's program on our website, www.assignment-asia.com. That's all the time we have for this week. I'm Ryan Chua. Thanks for watching, and join us again on Assignment Asia. Share your thoughts and contribute story ideas for future shows by contacting us on social media.
工廠企業，村民嚟講咧，搞出租房，咁咧整一條村嘅，如果講嗰個收入，原來一條村嘅總個收入，都係幾萬蚊，依家成個億，咁啊，你話嗰個變化係幾大啊？依家咧陸陸續續咧，凡係去香港的北京華客嗰啲更加要翻嚟啦，喺外國嗰啲咧都好多都係爭住翻嚟咧，要睇睇自己家鄉。哦，咁啊，外來嘅人口嚟講咧，即係大部分依家呢頭咧幾棟村民咧都係相合得，即係話都合得好嚟嘅。點解咧？因為依家呢頭咧搞商業，唔係搞農業。所有呢啲商業咧，都係靠外嚟嘅人口咧，大家嚟支持嘅，大家係相互嘅。咁咧呢個係確實係好難未，即係話要知道未來嘅，肯定會有一個仲有一個好嘅夢。